Okay, so I wanted to do a quick video about the celestial sphere. Now, this is an actual physical model of a celestial sphere, and I've got it set up for Tupelo, Mississippi. And what you're going to see is, well, first of all, inside there, there's a globe. I've actually got two celestial spheres, but I'm just going to spend time with this first one. There's a globe inside here, and then on the outside, there's a clear sphere. And that's where we're pretending all the stars live. In fact, it looks like the sphere has measles, but those are actually stars. In fact, the stars, some of them have names, some of them have the constellations, etc., etc. But, of course, it's not the way the world really works, but the stars do appear when we look up at the night sky. They appear to be these little dots that are on this big old globe that seems to be, or this big dome that seems to be moving. And so that's what the celestial sphere kind of operates on. It assumes that all those dots are the same distance from the Earth. They're all kind of placed on this dome that is over the Earth. And so the celestial sphere, first of all, also includes, there's a little sun in there. And notice as I spin, I can spin my Earth on the inside. And that shows the daily motion of the Earth. And if you were standing on the Earth, you would see those stars. In fact, I'm going the wrong way. I'm going this way. The stars would appear to move from east to west across your sky as the Earth rotates. And in 24 hours, they'd wind up showing up at the same location. It would take 24 hours for them to move essentially one time around or across the sky back to their original location. And same thing with the sun. On a daily basis, the sun appears to be essentially motionless with respect to those background stars. And it moves from our eastern sky to our western sky, and it sets, and then it rises back in the east, etc., etc., on a daily basis. However, during the course of the year, the sun does move. It moves eastward with respect to these background stars. And notice that on the celestial sphere, there's a little word that says August. And over here, there's July. So I can actually move my sun's position during the course of the year. Of course, this is not during one day, but over the course of several months and or weeks and or months, it moves until essentially it's changing its position with respect to the background stars. Remember, the Earth continues to spin, but now I'm in September, and my sun appears to be among different stars in the background compared to where it was back in July. I notice that at certain times of the year, the sun appears to be right over this line, which is our celestial equator. Again, you can see the equator on the Earth. If we project it outward and let it hit the celestial sphere, it creates what's called the celestial equator. That line right there goes around the celestial sphere. So, this path of the sun during the course of the year, we call the ecliptic. Again, the sun changes its position during the course of the year. Sometimes it's below the celestial equator, and sometimes it's right on the celestial equator, and other times it's above the celestial equator. And as you may have learned from if you build a solar motion demonstrator, the sun is, at least it's above the celestial equator, essentially in our summer, spring and summer. It is on the celestial equator at the equinoxes, and then it is below the celestial equator in the fall and in the winter, northern hemisphere. And again, each of these stars can be pinpointed. You can specify the location of a particular star by knowing, first of all, how far above the celestial equator it is. That's the declination value. And then you can also, of course, that's not good enough. We need to have another coordinate. So the other coordinate is derived from how far east that star is from the celestial, from the vernal equinox. Remember, the equinox is where the sun is right on the celestial equator. So boom. Here we are in March, late March. The sun is right on the celestial equator. We call that the vernal equinox. Over the course of several weeks and or months, the sun moves eastward amongst those background stars, and it's no longer on the celestial equator, it's a little bit above. If we define that point where the sun's path intersects the celestial equator as the 0 hour of right ascension, and then as it moves, when you move eastward from that point, we talk about hours of right ascension. There's 1 hour of right ascension, 2 hours of right ascension, 3 hours of right ascension. On my celestial sphere, if I can get close enough in here, there's a little number here. This is number. There's a 2 right here. That indicates that's 2 hours of right ascension, 3 hours of right ascension, 4 hours of right ascension, 5 hours of right ascension, etc., etc., until I get around here to 12 hours right ascension. And notice what happens. Here's that little dashed line. There's my ecliptic. My ecliptic intersects the celestial equator at 12 hours right ascension, because that is my autumnal equinox. Now notice where my dashed line. My dashed line, my ecliptic, is now below the celestial equator as we get into the fall and into the winter months, because the sun's declination is below the celestial equator during those times of the year. But again, the sun moves with respect to these background stars. The background stars don't. Any of these stars, their values don't change. They have the same declination, the same right ascension every day of the year. Because they're so far away, we assume they don't move. The sun, which is actually relatively close, does move because of the orbit of the Earth.